Father, we say that we are so grateful to you. We rejoice in everything that you've done for us. We glory in all the things that you've done for us. And it is the best of the best that you have given to us in giving yourself to us. And Father, that is why we are gathered here, that we will have a consistent, better understanding, an excellent understanding of all that you have done for us, not just in theory, not just, you know, as a figment of our imagination, but in the reality of the substance in Christ. Because of this, I claim for everybody under the sound of my voice that our interest through this teaching, through this fellowship, will increase, abound more and more in the area of accurate knowledge. And when we have that accurate knowledge, then we shall be able to make judgments of spiritual things, decisions of spiritual things. We will be able to decide clearly the difference between all that the Spirit has given to us and what the Spirit has not given to us. What the Spirit is emphasizing that we should practice, what the Spirit is not emphasizing that we should not practice. That is the aim of spiritual growth. And if there's anything that stands in the way of this spiritual discernment, the ability to be able to distinguish, differentiate between what the Spirit has given us that is worthy of emulation and practice, and what the Spirit has written, even though it is written, but it is not required for us to follow. That is maturity. That is where you want to bring us to. So I pray that the eyes of our understanding will be enlightened, that we shall grasp the spirit of wisdom and revelation, and that we should know this power, this right and privilege that you have given to us. And that right and privilege was given to us because Jesus was raised from the dead. And we should know about our rights. We should know about our privileges. We should know about who we are. We should know about the things that belong to us and the things that are not required. This is the journey you want to bring all of us to, not only for ourselves, so that when we know, when we meet others who have not come to this point of being able to separate and distinguish what is required from what is not required, we will teach them. And that is what discipleship is all about. Father, if there's anything that stands in the way of such an understanding, I come against it. Whether slowness to understand, dullness of perception, indifference, bigotry, pride, being self-conceited, unpersuadableness, traditions of men and women, personal private interpretations, and denominational things that does not conform to the syllabus of God's word. Only what Jesus has done should be our target. We thank you and we bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Glory. Hallelujah. Good, lovely afternoon. A lovely one at that. A really, really lovely one at that today on this scorching, sweltering heat in London. And that is really good. We miss it because it doesn't come all the time. So make sure you take advantage of this sweltering, you know, scorching heat. Get some vitamin D on your skin and enjoy the sunshine. But also be careful, don't stay too long in it, thereby not getting any sunburns. Glory to God. Anyway, this is me, Reverend Fred Abekam, saying a warm welcome to Full Gospel Church International, our daily teaching devotional, Epignosis Online, or Epignosis Daily Believers Bible Study Fellowship here. And I see that the vision of this church, as our slogan goes here for this branch, the Christ Revealed Center, is to reveal Christ as God in a human form, to reveal Christ in his resurrection, to reveal Christ in all that he has done for the believer, to reveal Christ in what he can do through the believer, and to reveal Christ in terms of what the believer can do through him and what is available. That is the mandate, which means bringing people to know Christ first as the savior of the world, and after they are born again, for them to know all that Christ has made available to them. That is discipleship. So evangelism and discipleship, the mandate of this ministry, which falls in line with the mandate of Jesus, Matthew 28:18, go into all the world and preach the gospel unto all nations, making disciples. Preach when they come, you make disciples. That is the mandate we have received. And I have a joy, and I am committed to that mandate until Jesus Christ returns. Thank you very, very much, Sister Angela. Thank you, Sister Nina. Thank you, Sister Sheila. Thank you, Sister Sherry. Thank you, Sister Jennifer. Thank you, Sister Vivian, for being here as you wait for others to join. So without much ado, let us get into our subject of discussion, as our theme for this year is spiritual growth. And I'm going to go with some angles of that spiritual growth. So I would say that follow carefully, and as always it is, your understanding will be always clear in that regard. All right, so here we are in spiritual growth, and this is lesson number 66, and this is season number one. So because of what I'm going to do today, we don't have time to waste. So I just make a quick summary that we said that spiritual growth basically is knowing very well the epistles, because they explain the Bible, knowing it very well, knowing it very well to the point that you can make a distinction that even though the Bible is recorded, but you must be able to separate, even though it is recorded, is it required? Is it necessary? Even though it's in the Bible, is it recorded? Is it not necessary? Being able to make that distinction in it is what we mean by spiritual growth. So when a person is not able to make that distinction between whether the fact that something is required, even though it is written, and something is no longer required, even though it is written, in itself shows whether the person is growing or not. So when the person is not able to make that distinction, it is in the Bible, but is it something we should still follow? It is in the Bible. Is it something we shouldn't follow? Once those areas in terms of percentage is still not clear, then that means that you are not growing spiritually. And it's not an indictment. It's not a looking down upon. It is a good thing. You know, that means that you should sit up and tell yourself, you know what? I can see that I don't know. I must learn. That was something that happened to me years ago when I heard Dr. Kenneth Hagin in one of his books. Somebody committed his book to me. I think it was the book, I Believe in Visions. And then in the very first chapters, he said something that struck me. And when he said that thing, I vowed that I don't want to make that mistake. He said that after 18 years in ministry, Jesus told him that all that he had been teaching was wrong. Jesus walked into his room and Jesus told him that I have the written word. The written word is final. It has got everything in it. But the way I am seeing that there's a lot of error in the body of Christ, that is why I've appeared to you like this. I will not do that again, because everybody must refer to the written word. The written word is the leveler. So it will not be fair on the rest of the body of Christ for me to appear to you and not appear to the rest. But I'm doing this because I know you are sincere and I know where you are going in terms of ministry. So he told him that 18 years, all that you have preached is not correct. So then can I take in asking that, Jesus, even though I am seeing you in living color, I won't accept that until you show me two or three Bible verses which tells me that what you are saying is true. Jesus said, no problem. At the mouth of two or three witnesses, let every word be established. So Jesus gave about three or four. And all were, one of them was from the Gospels and the rest were from the epistles. Then before Jesus left, according to Kenneth Hagin, as he was walking away from his bed, he turned back and told him that the secret in understanding the word of God are in the epistles. Be faithful to it in addition to the Old Testament, which is the blueprint. Next, another very important man of God, these two gentlemen, they've all gone to be with Jesus. Dr. Kenneth Hagin is going to be with Jesus. It is his first son that is in charge now. He's called Ken Jr., right? Ken Jr. is in charge now. Kenneth Jr. is almost about 60 years plus, right? Kenneth Hagin had a ministry of 60 years, and he was the one that, through him, he blessed the entire body of Christ. Most ministries sprung up from him. Okay, that's fine. Great. Then there came another man after that called Dr. Frederick Casey Price, who lives in California, Los Angeles, California, the famous faith preacher who built Faith Dome. He also said Jesus told him one day, this was not a physical appearance, as he was saying, he heard the voice. He said, all that you have been teaching is wrong. And that was after 11 years of ministry. 11 years. All that you have been teaching is wrong. Now, are you ready to follow the right way, or you want to go by your own way? And he said, okay, I'm ready to go the right way. Okay, that's great. Fantastic. Then he started. Okay. So the fact that somebody has been in Christ for years does not mean that they are growing spiritually. So when I heard that, I told myself, I won't want to make that mistake. So when I heard that the epistles are the explanation of the Old Testament, and the Old Testament is the blueprint. You can never understand the Old Testament by reading the Old Testament. You understand it by reading the epistles. I made a timetable. And you know what, folks? I just went. You know, I went for it. I was in there. So all of a sudden, things started to become clear. You know, then at a point, I stopped. Then I realized that I went back into confusion. Then I picked it up again. Right. So why am I saying this? Because in spiritual growth, there must be consistency. So for example, a lot of believers are still immature in the area of understanding how to explain forgiveness of sins and sins from the Old Testament to the New Testament as to whether sins are to be confessed or not. And this does not go with only even confession of sins. This goes with any other topic. Follow me very carefully. This goes with any other topic where there seems to be controversy. This goes with any other topic that goes with controversy. So the problem is this, that many believers, and I've repeated this, and I'm going to continue as we're going to go into how confession of sins, whether it's regarded or not, is to be done. We'll go into that in a moment. But I need to lay some foundation here. So please listen very, very carefully. Listen very, 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 very carefully. Before I go into that, I want to show you why I am doing this before I continue. I have observed, you know, being in Christ for so many years and being first an associate pastor, now I'm a pastor, now ordained minister of the gospel also. There's something I have observed, and this is my general observation. I've observed that the number one cause of inability to get clarity on the word of God is consistency in reading, consistency in learning, consistency in listening. I've observed that. So I've observed why is it that some people come into the light, then they fall away. They come into the light, they fall away. They come into the light, they don't understand. They come into the light, they are arguing. It's because of this consistency. So watch, I've said this all the time. They come, they hear the clear example, explanation of the word, they get excited. You know that. Then what they begin to do now is that they don't go back to relearn or reread. They are just listening. Like when I'm teaching, you are just listening to me, right? But you might not go back to check the Bible verses. You don't go back to check them. So now this is what happens. Then you hear somebody also teach. But because you've not checked for yourself, because when you check for yourself, it brings you to that place of persuasion. So now you listen to somebody else, right? And with that person, you do the same thing. You don't check. So now you're beginning to think, but it's in the Bible. This one said this. But now I'm confused. Exactly. You'll be confused because you listened, but you did not listen well. See that? The understanding is in continuing. Then the next thing that happens is that because now you are not patient, you know, very soon now this person now begins to now draw back. Now they are in today, they are not in tomorrow. Of course, everybody has got their genuine reasons. I'm only giving a general observation. They are in today, they are in not tomorrow. They are in today, they are in not tomorrow. They are in today, they are in not tomorrow. So the next thing that is going to happen is that there will be gaps in the understanding. Gaps begin to appear because now you're going to come to the back end of a consistent teaching. So now because there are gaps in it, right? You end up by saying, this Bible is complicated. You know, let me just think of myself there. And the Bible says in the parable of the sower that these people, not having root in themselves, immediately that the word of God is sown, Satan comes and steals the word away from them. So remember, it's not you. It is the understanding of the word that Satan wants to get it away from you. Because once you know that, Satan has lost somebody that he controlled. See that now? Now, the next thing that happens is that because you're not becoming in and out, you're becoming in and out, and you're not consistent, the next thing that will come in will be pride. You think you are justified in the little you know. You think you are justified. Then the fourth one that happens is the fact that now, indirectly, if the person doesn't want to continue, they can still come in, because I'm discussing this with my pastor friend and other pastors around the world, you know, that now they can come because of Zoom. Because Zoom, we can't see faces. That has become a very big help too, in a certain way. Because we can't see faces, you don't know whether the person is listening or they are not listening. Whether they are there or they are not there. Like I received a WhatsApp about 2 or 3 days ago of somebody who was, you know, apologizing that technically in all the teaching that the person was coming, I will not say he or she was coming, you know, they actually never listened. They just logged in and they put their phone in their bag and they went off and did something. By the time they came, the thing is over. Folks, seriously, you know, such an attitude, how do you expect to grow? No wonder people like that don't be confused. See, so if you are coming in to study, come in with an open, consistent heart. If I'm not giving myself to this consistently, I will not be here, and I'm still learning. So on any subject of the word of God, once there is no consistency, you will never understand. You will never understand. If you are in, out, that's part one. Part two, you yourself, you don't even have time to take notes and sit down and go through it. Then you have set yourself up for failure. That's what the word of God says. You have set yourself up for failure. So in understanding, in trying to understand this area of whether confession of sins are required or not, there's something we need to understand. That the word of God is complete. And this is where it gets wrong. Listen to the statement. I've heard believers say this. Not one pastor or not one preacher has got it all. Not one preacher has got it all. To say that means the Bible is not credible. Because the pastors are teaching from the Bible, and you are saying that not one person has got it all. To say that not one person has got it all means the Bible cannot be trusted. So that in itself, you're positioning yourself for deception. That is why the person is jumping from people, Facebook, YouTube, Facebook, here, listen, because you think, oh, one person hasn't got it all. That is not true. The word of God is clear on what the Bible is about. The word of God is clear on what the Bible is about. So in the book of 2 Peter, chapter 1, verse 19, he says, and we have the prophetic word made firmer still. Follow me and take note of the Bible verses. What is the prophetic word? Is it prophetic word about telling you that in 10 years' time, you're going to get a car or a house? No. The prophetic word is talking about the prophecies made about Jesus in typologies in the Old Testament. He said, we have that prophetic word made firmer still. You look at it. You will do well to pay close attention to it as to a lamp shining in a dismal, squalid, and dark place. When he says, as a lamp shining in a dismal, squalid, dark, he's talking about the understanding of the Old Testament writers. And also to us who have come after resurrection. The word lamp here, look at the word. He didn't say light. He said lamp. He didn't say light. He said lamp. The lamp, watch this. The lamp holds the light. Look at what I'm doing here. Look on the screen. This is the lamp. The lamp is the torch, what we hold. But on top of the lamp is the light. So when he says lamp, the Greek word is luchnos. He's talking about those who carry the lamp, right? And on the lamp is the light. Who are those who carry the lamp? The prophets of the Old Testament. From one prophet to another, from Abraham to Isaac, from Isaac to Jacob, from Jacob to Moses, from Moses to Samuel, from Samuel to all the prophets who wrote the word of God. They are the lamp bearers carrying a light. That light is the message of Christ. See that now? So he said, you will pay close attention to it, the prophetic word. So the lamp is at the prophets, and on top of it is the light, which is the prophetic word. See that now? He's saying, don't look at the lamp. Look at the light, the prophetic word. Don't look at Elijah. Don't look at Moses. Look at the content of what they are pointing to, the light. Do you see that now? So he said, you will pay attention to it as a lamp shining in a dismal, squalid dark until the day breaks through the gloom and the morning star rises in your hearts. Verse 20, yet you must first understand this, that no prophecy of scripture is a matter of any personal or private or special interpretation, loosening or solving, trying to solve it. You cannot solve it with your own personal understanding. For no prophecy ever originated because some man willed it to do it. It never came by human impulse, but men spoke from God who were born or moved or impelled by the Holy Spirit. See that now? So what he's saying is that the individual prophet is the lamp, but the words coming from his mouth is not of his origin. The words, the utterance from his mouth. Take note of the words. So the words are in origin supernatural. That means you must take note more of their words than sometimes their writing in which they try to explain. Because in that, they were spiritually dead. They were only carriers of the message. But they themselves, they don't have a full understanding of it. That's why he said, you must be careful to pay attention to it as a light in darkness until the day breaks. Until the day breaks is the coming of Christ. See that now? Now, so to answer that question, to say that no one person has got it all will mean that the Bible is not complete, and we don't know what the Bible is about. But that is never true. For the Old Testament people, yes. But for us after resurrection, no. How do we know that? 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians. I'm doing this so that this becomes a yardstick that you use to line up to deal with any subject matter in the Bible, whether it's confessions of sins are required or not, whether it's tithes, whether it's baptism in water, whether it's anointing oil. This is the litmus test to know, to understand how do you interpret. So look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2. The moment we say no one person knows it all, then it means the Bible is not credible, because that means we don't know. See that? The Bible is credible and is clear on its subject matter, but it is you and I who don't read it in patience and consistently, so we never arrive at seeing the whole picture. So look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2 from verse 1. As for myself, Paul is talking, brethren, when I came to you, I did not come proclaiming to you the testimony and evidence or mystery and secret of God concerning what he has done through Christ for the salvation of men. Don't forget, Paul was a lawyer. And he was a good one at that. under the feet of Gamaliel. Paul is saying that, listen, I did not interpret this Bible because I'm a lawyer. I noticed that there is a way that it ought to be explained. Though my law background may help, but the law background is not what I use to be able to explain it. He said he calls salvation of men in Christ the testimony of God. He calls salvation of men in Christ the evidence. He calls salvation of men in Christ the mystery that was not known. He calls salvation of men in Christ the secret of God. Why the secret? Because the Old Testament prophets did not know that that is what it's about. So that's why he said in verse 2, for I resolved to know nothing, to be acquainted with nothing, to make a display of the knowledge of nothing, nothing else, and to be conscious of nothing else among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Did you see that? I didn't come and talk about law. I didn't come and talk about circumstantial evidence. I didn't come and try and dazzle you with philosophy, economics, you know, management. No. That is not the aim of the writings. Then verse 4, and my language and my message were not set forth in persuasive, enticing, and plausible words of wisdom. So he calls, when I try to talk anything outside salvation in Christ, it is at its most, what? Trying to do what? Be persuasive and plausible in trying to sound clever. But my words were rather in the demonstration of the Spirit and power. A proof by the Spirit and power of God operating on me and stirring in my minds of my hearers the most holy emotions, and that's persuading them about what? Christ. So he says that when I speak, my aim is to make clear the distinction between prophets who, even though they all live in different times, but the theme of their prophecy, the theme of their prophecy was Christ. The theme of their prophecy. They never met. Isaiah never met Ezekiel. But yet, the theme of their writing is the same. That is what he's talking about. See that? Then he goes on. So he calls demonstration of the power, what? An explanation to distinguish that although they spoke, but they all spoke to one point, one arrival point, one conclusive point, salvation of men in Christ. That is the meaning of demonstration of power. The word demonstration of power, the Greek word is apodexis. It means to shine a torch on the surface so that we can clearly see. So we can clearly see Christ in the Old Testament. Then he goes on from verse 9. But on the contrary, as the scripture says, what eye had not seen, and ear has not heard, and has not entered into the heart of man, see that? All that God has prepared, made, and he keeps ready for those who love him. So that sentence still is in context. He said that under the Old Testament, though they spoke, he's just using the word eye and ear as a figure of speech to mean lack of understanding. Lack of understanding. They spoke about Christ, Isaiah 9:6. They spoke about Christ, Jeremiah 31. They spoke about Christ, Jeremiah 33, 31. They spoke about them in different ways, but they had no understanding. They didn't know that the main subject matter. Look at then verse 10, yet. So now Paul makes a distinction between, remember, his background in writing this are the books of the Old Testament. So now Paul makes a distinction that whilst the Old Testament people spoke and they acted, but they didn't know that the main focus of their speaking and their writing is about salvation of men that will come in Christ. Why? Because the background of all that was Adam's sin that prefigured that. So he said, yet to us, who is the us referring to? To the apostles, Paul, Timothy, John, James, Peter, the writer of Hebrews, and Paul, or they call them foundational apostles. God called them to lay the foundation in explaining the gospel. Yet to us, foundational apostles, God has unveiled and revealed them. We know what it is about. They did not know what it is about. So by Paul saying that, it means that we are now clear on the purpose and the reason for the gospels and the writings. So it is a closure. It is not open-ended. It's not, we don't know. It's just for the Bible, you can never know. No, he said, God has made us know what it is about. So he has made it clear. Because that was the context from verse 1 about the salvation of men's souls in Christ. He said, they didn't know that, but we know it. That means the entire Bible is about how God saved men in Christ. For the Old Testament people, they couldn't understand. So that is why it was typologies. For us, we understand that it's done. So we take advantage of it. This ought to be very clear. So that becomes the yardstick. So now on the back of that, what next? That if I understand that it concerns Christ and him crucified already, then my question ought to be, in any subject of the Bible, is Christ bigger than that thing? Yes. That is how you do it. Is Christ bigger than water baptism? Yes. Is Christ bigger than tithes? Yes. Is Christ bigger than confession of sins? Yes. Was it confession of sins that died for me? No. Was it water baptism that died for me? No. Was it tithes that died for me? No. Therefore, Christ is the summation of the entire Bible. Anything that falls outside Christ, you are then saying that Jesus' death is not adequate. So there's the law of what we call the greater versus the lesser. Which is the greater? The death of Christ for salvation or water baptism? That means all symbols are meant to point us to that event. He said, yet to us, God has unveiled and revealed them by and through his Spirit, for the Holy Spirit searches diligently, exploring and examining. Notice the exploring and examining in context. The exploring and examining goes back to verse 1. He talks about who, when you come down, he talks about how the Old Testament people, they were exploring. They were trying to understand everything, even sounding the profound and bottom things of God, the divine counsels, and the things hidden beyond man's scrutiny. Did he say believer scrutiny? Mankind under the Old Testament. They couldn't understand. See that now? He said, it has been revealed. Then he says, verse 12, now we have not received the Spirit that belongs to the world, but the Holy Spirit who is from God, given to us that we might realize and comprehend and appreciate the gifts of divine favor and blessing so freely. I want you to take note of that word. So freely and lavishly bestowed on us. What is it that has been bestowed on us so freely and so lavishly? Salvation by faith in Christ. Question, is there anything more serious than salvation in faith by Christ? No. Because if there was anything more serious than that, then Christ would have died for that. But Christ came because of the sin of Adam. Is there anything else? And if an incident as serious of Adam's sin that brought spiritual death, physical death, mortality, eternal death, and all the things that it brought along, including the aging of the planet, according to Romans chapter 8, and even that which we were the guilty party, he gave it to us for free. We only believed and received it. How then, other things will now require a price to pay. It does not make sense. So that's why he's saying that you must be careful, where we read in the second Peter, to pay attention to it so that you understand that trail of thought. He said, he'll sow what? Freely and lavishly bestowed on us by God. So what Paul is emphasizing is that if this whole huge thing that takes men out of, that takes men out of hell, salvation in Christ, came freely to us, why then are we now, after being born again, kowtowing to things that now would require demands? So he has made a clear distinction between the relationship style under the Old Testament, because they didn't know and this had not been done, and the relationship style. If a huge thing, I want you to think, just use think a little bit. If a huge thing like salvation is free, that is the main thing. Why now is he going to ask you that before I do something for you or I answer your prayers, you must give me this before? Then that cancels out salvation. That's why I said in verse 13, and we are setting forth these truths. Truths about what? That under the Old Testament, it was performance and they did not understand, but in us, it has been done and accomplished in him. So this truth we set forth in words not taught by human wisdom. You won't get this in secondary school. You will not get this in university. You will not get this in any of the literature or writings made by man. You won't get that. That's why he said that, not taught by human wisdom. To try and understand those things, trying to use human wisdom, will shipwreck your faith. We cannot go by the words of so-called people. They say that the great church fathers of theology. I don't know whether they know this. That's why I said that, not understanding that there's a style and there's a focal point of how the word is explained, will make you shipwreck in your faith. See that? Words not taught by human wisdom. That means Paul is saying that in the writings of the epistles is the closure. He said, but taught by the Holy Spirit, combining and interpreting spiritual truth with spiritual language to those who possess the Holy Spirit. That's why he said in verse 14, but the natural man, non-spiritual man, does not accept or welcome or admit into his heart the gifts and the teachings and revelation of the Spirit of God, for they are folly, meaningless, nonsense to him, and he's incapable of knowing them, look at the word, them of progressively. That's the key. Recognizing, understanding, becoming better, acquainted with them, because they are spiritually discerned, distinguished, and appreciated. So to say that, as for the Bible, we don't know all, we can never know all, is totally erroneous. The word of God is clear what the Bible is about. Salvation by faith in Christ Jesus and all the benefits that came out of it. So if you can understand that that whole huge, humongous task of salvation came freely, why would there be other things that require a condition? This side of salvation. That's why Paul is emphasizing that. Let's go to Romans chapter 1. From Paul, a bond servant of Jesus Christ, the Messiah, called to be an apostle, a special messenger set apart to preach the gospel, the good news of and from God, which he promised in advance long ago through his prophets in the sacred scriptures. Once again, the word scriptures, when Paul uses it here, don't forget that at the time he wrote the book of Romans as a letter, none of the books of the Old New Testament
none of the books of the New Testament have been put together yet. So he's not using the word scriptures to mean Acts, you know, Romans, Galatians. No. Whilst he wrote this, his reference books were the Old Testament, Genesis to Malachi. So he's saying that in Genesis to Malachi, the complete theme was the gospel of Christ promised. It was in a promissory language. So when you read it and you fail to see that, you will teach it in error. That's why he said, which he promised in advance long ago through his prophets in the sacred scriptures. The word sacred, it means hagios. It means writings of the Old Testament, but the subject matter only concerned itself with this, the gospel of Christ. Why? How do we know that? Verse 3, he said, which he promised in advance long ago through his prophets. What? The gospel. Look at it here. Look at it there. The gospel, what? Regarding who? His son. But they didn't know that. But that revelation came after resurrection when Jesus explained it in Luke 24 and gave it to the apostles. And so Paul was not in that meeting. So for Paul to pick this out from the Old Testament shown that the theme is the same. If we take our time to read it consistently, since that is the main theme of the Bible, if we are not in a hurry and we are not impatient and we are not proud and we take it and read it consistently together, we will all arrive at this conclusion that the Old Testament is about the gospel of his son, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, gospel of his son, then also the Acts, gospel of his son, then Romans to Revelation, gospel of his son. That is what he's talking about. Now, in Ephesians chapter 3, Paul uses a certain word because people say that, when Paul said that, I got it by direct revelation. Let me show you something that is missing that we can't see. Then he says in Ephesians 3, verse 1, for this reason, because I preach to you that you are thus built up together, I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for the sake and on behalf of the Gentiles, assuming that you've heard of the stewardship of God's grace, I was given the task to be a manager. To when I read the Old Testament, I must oversee to it, to manage it and let people see that it's concerning the gospel of Christ. He said, his merited from that was entrusted to me to dispense to you for your benefit, and that the mystery, he calls the Old Testament mystery. Why? Don't forget the language, because they read it, they didn't understand, was made known to me. Careful. And I was allowed to comprehend it by direct revelation. So we used to think that, Jesus Christ appeared to Paul and told him that this whole thing, this how it's meant. No, Paul and Peter used the word revelation differently. Listen to me carefully. When Paul uses the word revelation, he goes with the word apocalypsis. Listen to me carefully. That's why you have to study to know. When Paul uses the word revelation, mostly in his letters, his lexicon use of the word revelation is the Greek word apokalypso, which always refers to revealing Christ in the writings. Christ that cannot be seen in the writings. But when Peter uses the word the revealing of Christ, Peter uses a different Greek word. He used the word phanero. So Paul uses apokalypso to explain Christ. Peter uses phanero to mean the physical appearing of Christ when he returns. So what Paul meant by direct revelation was that he was not in that Luke 24 25 meeting when Jesus resurrected and met the 11 in an exclusive Bible study for him to explain to them the Old Testament was about him. Paul was not in that meeting. So when you mean by direct revelation that I was not in that meeting, however, in studying the Old Testament, I came by the same conclusion that Jesus gave all the 11 apostles minus Judas Iscariot. That's what he means. He came to that conclusion. So when Paul writes things like spirit, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. He picked it up from Jeremiah 31. He picked it from Ezekiel 36. The ability, that's why he's unique, that he was able to see that the scriptures are about Christ. That's why he said that, and that the mystery, secret was made known to me, and I was allowed to comprehend it by that direct revelation without having to meet Jesus personally, as I already briefly wrote. When you read, so what is he referring to now? His writings. His writings. His writings. His writings. When you read, now this is what I told you in the beginning, that why is it that many, when they come to Bible teachings like this, or when they are beginning to grow, they listen to this, but later you find out that they have not actually learned anything because of this word here. Verse 4, when you read this, you can understand my insight into the mystery. So the operative verb here is read. The word read here is the Greek word anaginosko. It means reading consistently, reading continually, reading to the point where now you take attention to details, reading to notice the context, reading to notice the closure, that the purpose of that writing is about this specific subject matter, salvation in Christ. That's why I said, when you read this, then you can understand consistently. So here, this is how people do it. They listen, they stop listening, they come today, they don't come tomorrow. I'm not talking about us here, I'm talking about this, the attitude of the general believers. It's hard to get a believer who is consistent in the study of the word of God. Some listen, they listen half. Some listen, they are not listening. You know, they have just, you know, somebody can even be in church, but they are not listening. Whilst you are teaching, their mind is on, you know, jollof rice. Their mind is on, you know, something else. They are not listening. Then they'll come back later and say, oh, but how come this and this and that? They are not. That's what Paul is saying. When you read or listen consistently as a lifestyle, not listening half, you will see the pattern. He said that you get understanding. The word understanding means to bring together, to bring together. To bring together, you can reconcile. So now I understand that the law was for Israel only. It was not for Gentiles. Therefore, I am not obliged. Therefore, I don't even need to argue over whether tithing is required, whether washings are required. I don't even need to argue. By just that knowledge, that the law is not for the Gentiles, it was for Israel. And that if I read well, I'll know that Abraham was already rich before he brought tithes. And even the tithes he gave it only once. What about forgiveness of sins? Confession. Confession was under the law. So when I use this barometer, this yardstick, it will be the end of all unnecessary. Hey, we don't even know. This one is saying this. 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 This body of Christ. We don't know. God help us. God, you know, it will be the end of that. Because it is a closure. It has got a finality. We know what it's about. Salvation in Christ. Anything else is secondary. That's why he said, this mystery was never disclosed to human beings in past generations, as it is, has now been revealed to his holy apostles. It has been revealed. The 11 apostles and others that came to join called foundation apostles and Paul by the Holy Spirit. See that now? It is this that the what is the revelation? Same thing. It is this that the Gentiles are now to be fellow heirs with the Jews, members of the same body of Christ, and joint partakers, sharing in the same divine promise, where in Christ. This is not difficult. Verse 7, of this gospel, no other, I was made a minister. See that now? Of this gospel, I was made a minister. He has made it clear. So when we go into, with this basis and our understanding, when we go straight into this subject about forgiveness of sins, then it's clear. It's very clear that we saw that under the Old Testament, that is when under the law, not even Old Testament, under the law, there was no confession of sins in Genesis. None. Listen, write it down. Do your research. There was not a single confession of sins under Genesis 1 to Genesis 50. Why? There was no law. It started in when it came out of Egypt. So we saw animal sacrifice had to be made. They would bring two goats. One of them, they would put the high priest would put the head, the hand on the head of the animal. Even under the law, for the sins of all Israel on the Day of Atonement, it was the high priest. It was the high priest that did the confession of sins. That's the shadow. Whatever is in the shadow was exactly how Jesus would do it when he came in on earth. You and I are not high priests. Jesus is the high priest. Showing that was a temporary structure. Then when we came into Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we said that Jesus forgave sins under Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John from what John preached. Jesus was not under the law. He was the reality of the law. Its fulfillment. That means Jesus in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John was still operating under the law. That is why they continued with confession of sins. But even in that, you saw that he, Jesus, in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, he gave forgiveness unconditionally. Clearly seen, John preached, because John was the last of the Old Testament prophets under the law. So John preached forgiveness of sins based on confession because the law required it. Galatians 4:4, when the fullness of time was come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law. And we are not under the law. So Jesus showed the difference. Whilst John was preaching, that forgiveness of sins was a condition that was predicated on confession of sins. Jesus was walking about forgiving people freely. That is what made the Sanhedrin and the Pharisees mad, because it looked like it was going against the law of Moses. They didn't know that he is the fulfillment of the law. That's why he said that, I did not come to do away with the law, but I came to fulfill it. People read that verse and they think that what it means is that Jesus has come to endorse the law. I came to fulfill it, to endorse the law. This meaning we still live in the law. We still go by the law, and we still go by after resurrection. That is not what that verse means. He came to fulfill it. The Greek means that he came to meet the requirements that no man could meet. I did not come to do away with the law. I came to meet his requirement because no man could, and they were guilty. That's what the Bible says in Hebrews, that he, Jesus, was tempted and tried in all points, just as we were, but was without sin. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, he who knew no sin was made sin for us, that we made the righteousness of God in Christ. So when we understand that, That's why I started with today. Then we are growing spiritually. The ability to know that the word of God has got its clear target of explanation. Once that thing is out of place, you will start, you will be confused when you hear this one on tithe. You hear this one, you are confused because you yourself, you don't know. You don't even know how the word is clearly explained, where the apostles made it clear. Law is for law, grace is grace. Finish. So even if Abraham did not tithe before the in under the law, yeah, you also know that there's also another law of Bible interpretation called the law of first mention or single mention. You cannot use one thing to make a doctrine. Abraham did it only once. So how can somebody give you big thing like salvation? Huh? Huge thing like salvation, which caused the man having to spend three to die. The man had 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 to die. Just because of the sins of Adam. Then after now dying and acquitting us and discharging us, now he's saying, if you don't bring so and so, you will not be blessed. Meanwhile, Ephesians chapter 1 has told us that we are blessed with all manner of spiritual blessings already in Christ. So look at that. He's saying, if I don't bring tithes, then the windows of heaven will not be open and you are cursed with a curse. Then Galatians 3:13 says that Christ has redeemed you from the curse of the law. Something is right, not right. Here, Malachi says cursed. Here, in Christ, says he's not cursed. Is there a contradiction? No. It is my inability to know that that statement was not even written to Israel. It was written to the priest. And everybody, when they are trying to teach tithes, will start in Malachi chapter 3. Why don't they start in Malachi chapter 1? Why don't they even start from Genesis, like Jesus' style of teaching, beginning at the writings of Moses? Why? Why do you just jump to Malachi 3? Have you read Malachi 1? Have you read Malachi 2? Have you read Malachi 3? Have you read Malachi 4? Have you seen what he's talking about? Why do you just cherry pick? And you have nothing to lose. Unbelievers don't bring tithes, but they are the ones who are the ones employing us. 95% of all industries are owned by unbelievers. And they and they decide your pay. And they decide my pay. If they say they don't pay you, you have to take a trade union. If they decide they won't pay you, God is not limited in one way. That was for the priest. So you see, because you are not reading, you can't even know the difference. So now you go and listen to this one, you are confused. You listen to this one, you are confused. You listen to this one, we don't even know. We don't know. We don't even know. It's a function of this. It's a function of this. That if you don't know what the gospel is about and its target, then you cannot make that distinction and make that comparison. So confession of sins was under the law. So that brings us to the next step tomorrow, which I'll continue. Now I'll deal with that 1 John 1:9. The only verse in the entire epistles that confession of sin was mentioned. So tomorrow we shall look at how the apostles taught confession of sins, whether it was required or not. So we have done before the law, we have done under the law, we have done in the gospels. Now from tomorrow with this background, we are now going to look at forgiveness of sins under the book of Acts. Let us see from Acts chapter 1 to Acts chapter 28, whether the apostles asked anybody to confess their sins. John the Baptist, yes, because he was under the law. But we'll see the apostles. That is why when Paul met some disciples in Acts chapter 19, going through the upper coast of Ephesus, he met certain disciples and asked them, have you received the Holy Spirit since you believe? They said, we don't know whether there be any Holy Spirit. He said, but unto what baptism were you baptized? He said, unto John's baptism. That means unto John's teachings. And what is John teaching? For God to accept you, there's a condition. Repent and confess your sins first. That was before Jesus died. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Amen.
Sister Sheila, bless you. Bless you. Yeah.